All right, welcome. The Center for the Advancement of Leadership, which is an amazing department here on campus, sponsors this conference every year. My name is Belinda Han. I'm the director of that center. Within our center, we have a wonderful program called the LEAD Program. Has anybody heard of the LEAD Program? The students you see in the green shirts are part of this program. It is a leadership development program that gives you a distinction on your academic transcript called a leadership distinction. It's something you need to be a part of. We want you to come here. We want you to join our program and become even better leaders for the world. And that's the reason we put this conference on. With that being said, there's a couple of housekeeping items. First, y'all have your programs, right? Hold your programs up. If you turn to the very back page, there's a spot for notes. Make sure you take notes. There's some wonderful speakers that will be here. Hold up your Fiber One bars. Oh, yeah. I have some advice, and I need everyone quiet. Do not eat more than one Fiber One bar. Trust me. Okay? All right. At the end of our opening keynote this morning, I will give you more instructions on where all of the breakout sessions will be. Take a look at that program. Take a look at the speakers you want to go and see. There will only be 2 breakout sessions, and there are a lot of wonderful speakers. So make sure you mark which ones you want to go to. That being said, we have the wonderful opportunity to have the president of our university here this morning with us. Excellent. President Holland, I've worked a lot of places. I've had a lot of bosses. And President Holland is perhaps the best boss that I've had. And we're excited to have him here with us this morning. Give him a round of applause.
Thank you, Belinda. Wow, there is a lot of energy in this room. And we don't even serve coffee here. That is pretty good. My Bulldogs are here, huh? And my kids go to school at Mountview, but that was sort of weak. Mountview, are you there? Okay, all right. That said, we love all of you. You are welcome to be here at Utah Valley University. I'm not going to be with you very long, just a few minutes this morning, but I wanted to personally welcome you to this campus and just say a brief word about leadership and then a word about Utah Valley University. You know, leadership is a really important thing. And I know I'm probably preaching the choir here. That's why you're here early on in the morning doing extra things to learn how to develop as a leader. I want to compliment you. That is a great, great thing to do. This world needs leadership. There are problems out there, there are opportunities out there, and those problems don't get addressed or those opportunities don't get seized because sometimes people just hold back and are not willing to be leaders and make a difference. And you are here because you're a difference maker. You're someone who's got the talent, the drive, the energy to get into something and make it better, improve things. Change things from the way they were happening. Get other people to follow you on a path that's going to make the world a better place. And that doesn't mean you get to be the king or the dictator or just tell people what to do. That's not what leadership is. Leadership is an ability to inspire. It's ability to conceive the world in a different and better way and try to help people see and follow you. And what I want to say is that if you're really serious about that, I can't imagine a better place to come to college than Utah Valley University. So we're grateful that you're here. You're going to have a great conference. Many of you may have thoughts of and plans to go to other institutions. That's great. We will hunt you down and arrest you. No, I'm kidding. You're free to go wherever you'd like to go, but I do think there's some things you ought to keep in mind about this place that's hosting this conference. Our leadership program here with the leadership of under Belinda and her colleagues here at Utah Valley University. We've been working on this for quite some time. This has just been ranked as for leadership programs around the world as in the top 10% of leadership programs internationally. Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you very much. So this is something we're very serious about here. We put resources into it. We've got programs. They're well developed. You're going to see this on display. I hope you'll take advantage of it. If you want to go to another school and have a lesser life, that's fine. Okay? But if you want to have a great life, you come to this conference and then you come to UVU, all right? Now, just a word about UVU. We are a serious institution. There are just a few words that we talk about here at UVU, and one of them is that we're serious. We tackle big ideas. We've got great academics here. Our faculty are cutting edge faculty from across the nation that we've hired in just the last few years. We've really transformed this place. Even if you look at the kind of infrastructure, the new buildings, the student life and wellness building, the classroom building, new science building, this is the mark of a serious university. We're also engaged. We talk about being engaged here, and I don't mean that in that special Utah County kind of way, all right? Thank you. So we talk about being engaged with the world around us, okay? We're connected to the real world. That may sound basic to you, but you'd be amazed how many universities get kind of caught up in the sort of theoretical world of intellectual life, and we push ourselves, but we push ourselves to make sure that our academic learning connects with the real world. How do you solve problems? So when you come here, what you will do in almost every class is work on a project or with colleagues or with a faculty member that will take what you're learning in the classroom and apply it to the real world. And you'll be out in the real world with not just internships and research projects, but community service learning and spontaneous sort of student projects that fit into the bill of what you're trying to do to complete your degree or that coursework. It's a very exciting, dynamic way to do education. And then we talk about being inclusive. There is something here for everyone. We have certificate and two-year programs in the trades and technical education. We have four-year degrees in sciences, humanities, education, technology. And we welcome people from all walks of life, different races, colors, religions. Everybody is welcome here. And we want you to know that that's the hallmark of a UVU institution, is that wherever you're coming from, maybe you feel really prepared and you come from a kind of good traditional family here in the Valley, great, you're going to love this place. Maybe you're new to this area. Maybe your family doesn't have background in education. Maybe you'd be the first one to go to college. This would be the place for you. We've got lots of resources to help you with that. Because, and this is my final thought for you today, for us, everything hinges on one thing. Our core theme is student success. We're here to help you succeed. And that's what we wake up thinking about, dreaming about, wanting to do. And I think you'll feel that on this campus. And I think you'll feel that in this conference. And that's my last thought for you today is, again, wherever you end up going, I hope you'll sort of buy into this theme of student success, because that only happens with leadership. I hope you go home from here, from this conference, inspired, ready to be a leader, wherever you may be, to help other people succeed. That's fundamentally what leadership is about. It's not about you. It's about helping other people achieve their fullest potential, helping an organization get to greater heights, helping to completely reconceive of a social issue and go to address it and change it because it will improve people's lives. That's why we're here together, ladies and gentlemen. It's not about you as an individual. It's about making this world a better place. And you are in the right place today to learn about that. We're extremely proud of you, of what you're doing in your various high schools. So you keep going on. You make a great difference. Have a great life. And thank you for being here today.
Thank you so much. All right, before we move on, one more round of applause for President Holland. I want you to know that he probably had 15 options this morning on where he could be, and he chose to be here with you. And I think that says something about our great president. So, Thank you. All right. I want everyone who has a social media tool, like cell phone, right? I want you to pull it out. Take a selfie with somebody. Ready? You've got 10 seconds. Go. Okay. Now I need you to post it on Instagram or on Twitter with the hashtag. Are you ready? With the hashtag UVU lead, LEAD. So hashtag UVU lead. Put it on Instagram or Twitter. Do you know why? Because at noon, yeah, you sure can. Ready? Because at noon, I'm going to take a look at all of the pictures you take throughout the conference, and I'm going to choose the best one. Now, make sure they're appropriate. Best means the most creative, the most supportive of the conference and what you're learning. Take a picture with the speakers. Post short clips about what you're learning. And at noon, I will choose a winner, and I have a prize that nobody knows about. So this is a new thing for Betsy if she's thinking, what the heck? I have one. Okay. That being said, Alan Walker is our student president. He is on scholarship with our office. He receives a $5,000 annual cash award. It is a stackable scholarship for those of you guys that know what that means. And he is a fabulous leader. He is going to introduce our keynote. So Alan, let's give him a round of applause. Come on up.
How's it going? She meant to say 10,000, right? I'll get the rest later. I'm just kidding. That's terrible. But yeah, my name is Alan Walker. I'm the student body president for the Center for the Advancement of Leadership. It's actually pretty cool. This program is amazing. You've heard a little bit from Belinda, and you've heard some from President Holland, but this is an amazing program. The opportunities that come from this program and from what you're going to learn today are astronomical. It really is outstanding. So I hope all of you guys inside this room, especially for waking up this early and coming here, who was in the back that had to drive for like 5 hours? Yeah, I feel so bad. But you know what? You guys are amazing. If you can wake up to come to a leadership conference and spend 5 hours in a car, that's incredible. You guys are really dedicated and serious to leadership. So without further ado, let's get an introduction for our keynote speaker. So our speaker today has been speaking professionally for over 7 years. Hoan has been speaking across North America, is an acclaimed author, the recipient of the Verizon Wireless Motivator Award, and a competitor in NBC's hit show, American Ninja Warrior. Yeah, pretty cool. In addition, yeah, we'll have we'll get out a little later some stuff that he can practice on. So, I'm just kidding. In addition to speaking, Hoan enjoys constantly being mistaken as a high school student. Recognized as the best youth mentor by the International Examiner, please help me welcome Hoan Do.
I'm curious, by show of hands, how many have friends that are talented? Whether they're athletic, really good in school, musically talented? Okay. So check this out. It's my first year in school, and as I'm making new friends, I begin to realize all my friends are amazingly talented. I mean, they could sing, dance, play a musical instrument, you name it, they could do it. Personally, for me, I was jealous. Why? Because all my friends could be part of the talent show, whereas I could not. See, the only thing I was good at in high school was that I could wrestle. Now, do we have any wrestlers here? Show of hands. Okay. Now, let me tell you something. Wrestling takes a lot of skill, but it's not really a talent. Why? Because you can sing in public, you can dance in public, but you can't go outside and start grabbing random people. Begin wrestling them. You can, but a little awkward. So after talent show was over, I was like, man, I need a talent. So I enrolled into acting. Now, anyone here take acting and drama? Make some noise for me. Okay. Now, I want to share with you, if you haven't taken acting drama, it's okay. I just want you to know it's just really, really difficult. Why? Because all the assignments seem to push you outside of your comfort zone. I'll give you an example. Teacher sits us down. He says, guys, our next assignment is unlike anything we've ever done. It is called the rock star assignment. Now, we're about halfway through the semester, so my confidence is at an all-time high. So I'm like, Mr. Campbell, bring it. He then says, for this assignment, you must choose a song you're not normally listening to. You must choreograph a dance. You then must lip sync it in front of the entire class. In that moment, I thought to myself, OMG. I'm walking back home from school. I'm like, dude, what I do? What if I embarrass myself? What if my friends make fun of me? All these what-ifs start going through my head. But all of a sudden, I stop. I'm thinking, oh my gosh, brilliant idea. I don't have to do this assignment. I'm just going to figure out how many points it is worth. You know where I'm going with this, don't you? I'm going to skip the assignment, make up those points doing something else. So I get home, I'm all relaxed. I find my syllabus, rock star assignment, 100 points. Underneath, though, in big, bold letters, it says you must do this assignment to pass the class. In that moment, I realized I had a difficult decision to make. Was I going to pursue my goal of learning how to act, but maybe embarrass myself along the way? Or was I going to let my fears, my doubts, other people's thoughts hold me back from achieving my goal? Now, the reason why I share this story with you is because I feel that's a lot like life. You see, you may not want to learn how to act, but maybe for you, it's getting a 4.0 this upcoming school year. Maybe for you, it's getting into your dream college. Maybe for you, it's getting a certain leadership position on your campus. Maybe for you, it's saying hello to that cute girl or guy that you've noticed while registering for this conference. Some of you are smiling because you know it's true. Regardless of what your goals are, as you pursue them in life, you're constantly going to encounter OMG moments along the way. And I believe your ability to succeed doesn't come down to your age, your background, your skin color, what you have or what you don't have. It comes down to the decisions that you make. And in the short time we have together, I want to share with you the three most important decisions that will help you to succeed in school and in your lives. Now, before we begin, I want to be very upfront. I want you to know I'm not here this morning as a speaker to lecture to you. Why? Because it's never fun for someone to talk at you, right? You sit in classroom, teacher talks at you. You get in trouble by parents, they talk at you. You get in trouble by boyfriend or girlfriend, they talk at you. It's never fun. So I want you to know, think of me this morning, less of a speaker, but more like an older brother. You know, like a funny, cool, amazingly good-looking, and humble older brother that's just here to have a conversation. But to have a conversation, you need at least how many people? Help me out. Two. So there'll be times I'll be asking you questions. If it relates to you, yell back the answer. There'll be times I'll ask you to raise your hands. If it relates to you, raise your hand. Why? Because if we can have a conversation this morning where we go back and forth, I guarantee you we'll have a lot more fun, time will fly by, and you'll take more away from our time here together. So if you're up for making this less of a lecture but more of a conversation, do me a favor, raise your right hands and say, OMG. O-M-G. Can't believe you guys did that. No, it's okay. So here's the thing. I know we have leaders from all across the state. I mean, I just noticed where somebody drove 5 hours, which is remarkable. It just shows your commitment to becoming the best leader and person you can be. And with that being said, I know we have probably a wide range of people from different grades. And I'm curious, regardless of where you fall into life, whether you're freshman, sophomore, junior, senior, or you're an advisor, is it fair to say that life can be stressful, yes or no?
Yes.
And here's the thing. The common advice I hear is if you're stressed out, you're going through the challenge, this is why I always hear, you just need to have a positive attitude. Now, if you heard this advice before, do me a favor, go and cross your arms like this, turn to the person next to you and be like, man, I heard that before. Now, let me tell you something. That is the worst advice ever. Why? Because it's easier said than done. Any of you have had one of those weeks in school where anything that could go wrong goes wrong? Yes. It's Sunday night, you're like, oh my gosh, I'm so overwhelmed. Sports, volunteering, school, oh my gosh, I just need a break for once. So you lay down in bed, it's like 9 o'clock, you're like, finally. All of a sudden your eyes open, oh my gosh, that paper, oh my gosh. You pull an all-nighter, you crank this paper out, you get to class, you turn in, you're so tired, your eyes are so heavy, you can barely keep it open. You go to the next class, you get your test scores back, you totally bombed the test. Not only are you tired, but now you're upset at yourself. You go to your next class, teacher yells out, pop quiz, for real? Aw. You're tired, you're upset, now you're stressed out. So as you sit down at lunch, you're like, dude, this is like the worst day ever. Your friend sees you, being the good friend they are, they say, hey, you okay? You're like, no, this is horrible. They're like, you know what? You just need to have a positive attitude. You take a second, you try to stay calm. You're like, you know what? Man, you just need to shut up. Because that's not helping my situation right now. You see, I think oftentimes as leaders, we have this idea like we always have to be positive, you know, because people are looking up to us. But the challenge with that is one, it's easier said than done. But two, is oftentimes people will pretend that everything's okay when things aren't. They put on a front, a mask. You see, I remember it was my senior year in college. My best friend, Chris, we're rooming together. He came home. I knew something was wrong. Why? Boom! Door slammed shut. He walks in the room. He takes his textbooks. He throws it against the wall. Books hits the wall. I turn around. I'm like, hey, Chris, you okay? He's like, I'm fine! Obviously, you are. I then notice on the ground his cell phone broken in half. I'm thinking, bro, if that's what you do when you're feeling fine, let me know when you're feeling awesome. Because I don't want none of my stuff near you. But after talking for a couple minutes, he's like, I'll be honest, man, school's so tough. My girlfriend and I, we're not getting along. I'm not talking to my parents. Life's challenging. And what I want to share with you is that's right. Life is challenging. And rather than trying to always be positive, I think it's more important. The first decision that you need to make as leaders to succeed comes down to making sure you have the right attitude. What that means is when things happen, you always acknowledge how you feel. So for example, how many of you feel overwhelmed because you have so much going on this upcoming school year? I want you to know it's okay to feel overwhelmed. How many are stressed out because you have no idea where you want to go to college or what you want to do when you graduate? I want you to know it's okay to feel stressed out. Why? Because we're all like soda cans. What happens is we go throughout the school year, life shakes us up. All of a sudden you have that one difficult class. All of a sudden you have that setback. All of a sudden you have that personal challenge, something happening in your life. Life shakes us up, and unfortunately, as people hold that tension inside. And like a soda can, if you keep shaking up that soda can and you don't release the carbonation, what happens when you open it? Explodes. And that's what happens to too many people. So if you're going through a tough time, realize it's okay. Acknowledge how you feel. How do you do that in life? Simple. Whether it can be exercising, it can be talk to a friend, talk to someone that you can confide in, maybe it can be journaling, but you've got to let that tension, that carbonation outside your personal soda can. Does that make sense? Yes or no? Second thing you do is don't make the situation worse than it is. I'm not sure about you, but I know there's sometimes it's so easy to blow things out of proportion. You guys know what I'm talking about? Nod your heads, right? You're like, oh my gosh, worst day ever. And in the moment, it feels that way, but when you give it some time, you realize, no, it's not that horrible. But realize it's okay to have a pity party. But the key thing is once things are tough, you acknowledge how you feel. Don't make it worse than it is. But then the third thing is you see things the way you want it and you do something about it. You see, if you want things to change, you must do something different. You know, for me, a lot of people talk, Juan, you know, how do I make sure I get this awesome job or get into college? And I share, it's all about real-world experience. And now the president talked about how Utah Valley University talks about providing real-world experience for students so that you're prepared for the real world. And I agree with that completely. And I'll give you an example. Think of it this way. Think about when you got your driver's license. How many tests did you take? Hopefully two. You get a written test so you know the rules. And number two, you actually take a driving test so you know if you can actually drive, right? So if you ace your written but fail your driving, do you get your license, yes or no?
No.
And guess what? It's the same thing with life. So it's important, having opportunities like this, so you go to a leadership conference, hearing from speakers, connecting with students from different schools. I mean, you can read about in a book about how to connect with people, but to do it in real life, that's a different thing. So I encourage you is get involved in your campus. Make sure you volunteer, get those job opportunities, because that gives you real world experience to supplement what you're learning in school. If you follow me, say yes. Here's what's key though, is I know some of you are like, oh, I want attitude, have the right attitude, this is awesome. But here's the thing. I know, you guys know, attitude is important, but here's the dilemma. A lot of speakers talk about attitude, but no one shows you how to change it when times are tough. Because it's great and it's easy to have the right attitude when things are going well, but when things are challenging, how do you get out of that slump? And I want to give you a technique that will help you to do that. It's called changing the radio station. So imagine this. You had a tough week in school, you jump in the car, all of a sudden you're stressed, but then all of a sudden your favorite song pops on the radio. What do you do? Man, you turn it up. You start jamming, you dance, you feel good. All of a sudden, though, the song ends. And the next song is a horrible, annoying, whack song that absolutely kills the mood. Now, do you continue listening or do you change the station? What do you do?
Change it.
Well, here's the thing. Whether you know it or not, we all have radio stations up here in our heads. Oftentimes, though, it plays whack songs. Songs that sound like this. You can't do that because you're not smart enough. You can't do that because you're not athletic enough, because you're not pretty enough, because you're not something enough. And unfortunately, we're never taught how to change this radio station up here. You see, for me, going throughout high school, my whack song was that I was never good enough. And the challenge that was that my self-esteem was always based on how I compared to other people. And the thing is, from the surface level, things looked great. I was a 3.7 GPA student, top 10 in wrestling. I got accepted to go to Pepperdine University down in Malibu, California, prom king, all that stuff. But what people did not see and know was I was depressed. Why? Because I struggled with math. I struggled with pre-calculus. And I remember I go to tutoring before school, I stayed afterwards, and I just did not get it. And what frustrated me the most is when I look over to my friends, they would breeze through the class. It was so effortless for them. And I get so upset at myself. I'm thinking, Hoan, what's wrong with you? Boom, Hoan, it's because you're not good enough. I remember it was my senior year, state tournament for wrestling. I lost my first match, second match I'm going. If I win, I advance in the tournament. If I lose, I'm done. It was third round, scores tied. Guy was on top, I was on the bottom. 3 seconds left. If I got up, escaped, I get the 1 point, I win. 3, 2, 1. I get up, I hip heist, I break his grip, I stand back, ref gives me the point, he raised my hand, I'm so excited, I run off the mat, and as I'm running off, all of a sudden the ref yells my name. I turn around, he goes to the score table, he takes my point, he doesn't explain why, but now we're in sudden death, so first person who scores wins. So we get reset, get ready to go. He blows the whistle. I step back, and as I shoot in, I slip. Guy gets behind me. He gets the 2 points, and he wins. And I remember I walked off to the mat, and I sat on the side, tears rolling down my cheeks, and all I could think about was all those early mornings I woke up to go to the gym to lift weights before school started. All I could think about was the summers that I went to wrestling camps to make sure I was ready when season started. All I can think about was all the weekends I gave up hanging out with friends to prepare for this one moment. And at the end, I thought to myself, what went wrong? And then all of a sudden, I heard in my head, boom, Hoan, it's because you're not good enough. And for me, I had different moments in school where if I'm not really good enough, why should I continue trying? And because of that thought, I was depressed and had suicidal thoughts. Fortunately, there's a caring adult that reached out to me, like the adults that came here with you to bring you to this conference. And this adult helped me to realize that that wax song on my radio station wasn't true. The reason why I bring this up is because we all have wax songs playing in our radio stations. I'm curious which ones are playing in yours. Do you have a wax song about your ability to lead at your school? Do you have a wax song about your ability to graduate and get into that college or get that job that you want? Do you have a wax song about the relationships in your life? Because what I want you to recognize is these songs were written by something that happened in the past. Maybe you had a setback in life. Maybe you made a mistake. Maybe someone made fun of you. And what I want you to realize is the past is the past. You can't change that. But what you can change is everything moving forward. Why? Because your past doesn't predict your future. The mistakes you made do not define who you are as a person. And your setbacks in life does not determine your success. Why? Because oftentimes, your biggest breakdowns in life can provide your biggest breakthroughs in life. As long as you make the decision to change that song. So the next time you're feeling yourself overwhelmed, you have that doubt, that negative self-talk going through your head, this is what you do. You say, hold up, that is whack. Some of you look around the ballroom, you're like, no one? That was whack. Now, I know it's silly, but it works, and for two reasons. Number one, it's so silly, it makes you laugh. And when you laugh, do you feel better, yes or no? And when you feel better, you can think clear and make better decisions than when you're stressed out. Because how would you agree that when you're stressed out, oftentimes you say things and do things you do not mean? Show of hands. Right? So number one, you feel better. Second reason why it works, it is so random. It will make you temporarily forget about what's stressing you out. For example, have you ever had one of these in school? You're talking to a friend during lunch. As you're talking, you can't help but realize out of the corner of your eye, you notice that cute guy or girl for one of your classes. As you talk to your friend, you can't help but notice that your head is slowly moving over so that you can appreciate the beauty that is in front of you. Your friend's talking to you, you don't hear a single word. All of a sudden they hit you in your shoulder because they're so mad you're not listening to them. Why'd you hit me? What's stressing you out? Oh, I'm sorry, I totally got distracted. What were we talking about? Has that ever happened to anybody here? Show of hands. For those who are raising their hands, thank you for your honesty. For those who didn't, you are liars. JK, no, not really. So here's the thing. When you say, hold up, that is whack, that's like you changing the radio station in your car. But if you change the station in your car and you don't like that song, you're going to find another song that you actually like. So how do you do that in real life? Simple. You're like, hold up, that is whack, because the truth is, then you give yourself a reminder why that negative self-talk isn't true. I'll give you a story from my life. I remember there's this girl I wanted to talk to, right? So I'm like, all right, I'm just going to go up and talk to her. So I'm walking towards her. All of a sudden, boom, I stop. Why? Because I had all these whack songs in my head. I was like, Juan, what if you go up to her and she's like, ew, get away. What if she's like, ew, get away, then your friends see you. What if she's like, ew, get away, your friends see you, then they start making fun of you. So I was like, oh, dude, I got to change my station. So I had to remove myself from the situation. And I was like, man, hold up. That is whack, because the truth is, man, I got swag. And here's the thing, when I said out loud, I was like, yeah, I do. Because here's the thing, I don't know you personally, but what I do know is that you've gone through challenges in your life and you've also overcome challenges in your life. Is that fair to say yes or no? Yes. And here's the thing, oftentimes when we're stressed out, we all of a sudden, we always focus on the problem. I mean, think about it. If you're stressed out, oh my gosh, I need to study for the test. What if I fail? Oh my gosh, I'm running late for this meeting. What if this person doesn't get me for this job? We start panicking. And we stop focusing on the problem and forgetting about the solution and also what we've done. So when you say, hold up, that is whack, it makes you laugh so you can take a mental step back, go back into your long-term memory, and remind yourself of things that you've actually done. So if you have a tough week in school, it's like, hold up, that is whack, because the truth is, I am stressed out. But I remember last semester, I had that one week in school. That was by far the most difficult week I've ever experienced. And if I can make it through that week, I know I can make it through this week. All of a sudden, something happens in your personal life. And you're like, dude, this is so difficult. We can't make this happen. All of a sudden, it's like, hold up, that's whack. Because you know what? This is painful. But the truth is, a couple years ago, we went through this experience. If we can make it through that, we can make it through this. You see, it's not about positive thinking. It's just you going back to your long-term memory, reminding of things that you've actually done to draw upon to give yourself the confidence to deal with any challenges you're presented with in front of you. Does that make sense? Yes or no?
Yes.
Here's what's key, though, is that when you change your station, you have to keep playing new songs, meaning you have to continue giving yourself reminders why that negative self-talk isn't true. Why? Because, I mean, if you're listening to the radio and a whack song comes on, like a One Direction song, if you change the station one time, the song will still be stuck in your head. It's the story of my life. I take her home. Don't pretend like you don't know the lyrics. So back to my story, right? I had to keep changing my station. So I was like, man, hold up. Man, that is whack, because the truth is, I'm the bomb. Hold up. That is whack, because the truth is, man, I eat problems like this for breakfast. Man, hold up. That is whack, because the truth is, man, I want lean, mean, sexy machine. And here's the thing. When you say things out loud with conviction, will you believe it? You become what I call lethally confident. This is the type of confidence where, like, you're working on a group project and everyone's all stressed out except you, and you're just looking around. You're like, move. Man, get out the way. I got this. That's lethal confidence. But rather than just talking about it, I want you to experience it for yourself to see if it works. I want you to think about right now, what's that whack song playing in your radio station? What's that negative self-talk going through your head? Now, why don't you repeat after me? Hold up. That is whack. That effort was whack. Be real. Scale from 1 to 10 as a group, 10 being all-out effort, 1 being didn't even try. Would you agree that that was not a 10, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. Important follow-up question. Why didn't you give it a 10? Juan, I'm tired. Man, I wasn't ready. I came to this conference to make friends, not lose friends. Whatever your reason be, it might be true. You might be tired because you travel far away. You might we're not ready. You might think it's silly. Whatever it is, what I've done this with elementary school kids up to grown adults all across North America. And what I've realized, the root cause, what the wax on the head was, like, well, Juan, what if I look silly? And if you look silly, it's about worrying about being judged. And I want to share with you is, unfortunately in life, you're always going to be judged. But what is fortunate is you can let go of the thoughts of people who are not important to you. Unfortunately, like attitude, it's one of those things that's easier said than done than actually listening and stop caring what people think. So for me, it's about flexing that muscle called courage. Right? That's what's helped me, where when you're courageous, it's not being scared, it's just acting in spite of it. When you flex that muscle called courage, things get easier. Whether it's you seeing someone being bullied at your school, or you see something that's injustice, you step in. All of a sudden, you want to talk to that guy or girl, you're scared to do it, but then you still do it. You want to apply for that college, but what if I don't get in? You still do it. Why? Because anything that's important to you is going to have you stretch outside of your comfort zone. But what's cool is when you stretch outside of your comfort zone, when you pursue what you truly want, you come alive. You can feel it. You get excited. Guess what? Anything that scares you, when you get ready to do it, you're going to be scared doing it. While you do it, you're going to be scared. After you do it, it's still going to be scary. But the more times you do the things that scare you, it's like exercising that muscle. The more you exercise, the easier the weight gets. Does that make sense? Yes or no?
Yeah.
So here's the thing. My challenge to you, because I know, for me, when you talk about level 10, level 10 is giving it your all. You're level 10. And for me, I know that you're level 10 leaders because you came all across Utah State to come to this conference. Would you agree with that you're level 10 leaders?
Yes.
Yeah.
Woo! I'm so convinced. Would you agree with that, yes or no?
Yeah.
So here's the thing. I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to give you a second chance, but your challenge is you have to give a level 10 effort for this exercise. So what's key is this. Important. First step to make the full effect of this technique is, without talking, stand up. Step two, you must include the hand motion. This is critical for this to work. Bonus step, extra credit, go and insert a little attitude. And ladies, I know you know what I'm talking about. And here's the thing. Some of you are like, oh, Hoan, man, I don't want to look silly. If you're concerned about what people look at you, just stare at the ceiling because no one will stare back at you. But here's my thing. Commit to level 10. Because some of you are like, oh, Hoan, I don't want... Try it out. If it works, you can use it. It feels good. If you think it's stupid afterwards, you don't have to ever do it again. But just try it out. Is that fair to say yes or no?
Yes.
So here's the thing, is I want to be so loud the entire campus can hear us. So what's going to happen is I'm going to clap it up so we warm up. I'm going to count one, two, then three. After I count to three, then I'll be like, hold up, and then you start repeating after me. Make sense?
Yes.
Let's clap it up. One, two, three. Hold up.
Hold up.
That
is whack.
Because the truth is, I am.
I am
the bomb.
Hold up.
Hold up.
That
is whack.
Because
the truth is,
I eat
problems
for breakfast.
Man, I said hold up.
That
is whack.
Because
the truth is,
I got swag.
Give the person next to you a high five and have a seat. Grab that from you. Press pause. Awesome. Thank you. If you didn't hear me clap once, hear me clap twice. Now, did that feel a little silly, yes or no? For the most of us, yes. But do you feel better, whether it's more energy, more relaxed, more silly, or just overall better mood than you were just a couple seconds ago, yes or no?
Yes.
Here's my thing. It's silly, but it works. And personally, I'd rather feel silly for a moment and be like, wow, I feel so much better. Now I can handle this challenge, this problem, or I can move on with my day than be like, Juan, I'm too cool for this, man, and continue being stressed out. So anytime you're feeling self overwhelmed, it could be at this conference or back at school, help your fellow leader to change their radio station, right? Advisors, adults here, anytime your student leaders give you some lame excuse like, oh man, I was running late, I forgot something. Hold up, that is whack. It's universal, can work multiple different ways. Now, here's the thing, is I'm on a 30-day road trip right now, or tour, and I've been ping-ponging back and forth from Idaho, New Jersey, Virgin Islands, you name it. I came here, I just came from, where did I go from? My memory starts going when I travel a lot, but I just came here from Denver. And personally, I love what I do, not because of speaking-wise, but I love what I do because I get to connect with people. So I'll be here today until the beginning part of lunch. So after we're done, we'll have some time, you had breakouts. I'll be back there if you want to come by. Say hello, give me a high five, a hug, whatever floats your boat. I love connecting with you in person. But the reason why I love connecting is I get to learn about people's stories. And oftentimes people ask me, hey Juan, you know what? One of my biggest challenges is like, how do I figure out what I want to do in life? And for me, it's real simple. It's like figuring out your style of clothing, right? Think about it, you go to the mall, you try on a shirt, it doesn't fit, it's too baggy. You grab another shirt, try it on, but it doesn't look cute, so you put it back in the rack. Then you grab another shirt, you look in the mirror, you're like, that's on fleek. And you buy it, right? Well, guess what? It's the same thing with life, where it's a trial and error process, right? We're also like, want to have so many passions, what do I choose? Well, guess what? You try one thing on at a time. A lot of times, I know some of you, I feel you, where sometimes your parents or adults will be like, oh, sweetie, you are so lucky. You're like, why mom, why dad? They're like, because you have so many options. I didn't have it when I was a student like you. They're like, that's the problem. So many options, what do I choose? Well, guess what? It's just trying on outfits. So you're like, oh, I think that club's really cool. Go to a meeting. If you like it, continue wearing that outfit. All of a sudden, you're like, oh man, I want to do this when I grow up. And all of a sudden, you volunteer doing that profession, helping one. And you're like, oh my gosh, this is not what I expected. I don't like this at all. Guess what? It's okay. Take off the outfit, put it back in the rack, try something else on. And what I want you to realize, if you don't know what you want to do, it's okay, it's normal. The key is that you can decide how fast you figure out the right outfit. What's key, though, is that when you go shopping, or when you try to shop in life to figure out what you want to do, is when you find that right outfit, that right fit, is that you wear it. Why? Because so many people I meet, they're like, oh, I chose to go to this college because all my friends are going there. I chose this profession because my parents wanted me to. And as they pursued these goals, they achieved them, but in the end, they weren't happy. Why? Because they achieved these goals for other people, not themselves. But I think more importantly is this, is that when you choose the right outfit, you come alive. But in addition, is that there's so many people you don't know right now that are depending on you. You see, for me, I figured out that this was my right outfit as a junior in high school. So when I went to college, everything I did was very intentional. So when I graduated, I wrote a book called Succeeding in the Real World, What School Won't Teach You, sharing practical advice from a young person to other young people. And I was doing a book launch in Washington State, where I live, at the largest university. And the thing was, everyone was so supportive, except one person. I got this email because it came across this professor's email somehow. Their schools were promoting me, and this professor from the university says, Hoan, this is really great what we're trying to do, but come on, you're 22 years old. You're 22, what can you teach my students that I cannot teach them? All of a sudden, when I got that email, all of a sudden those whack songs start playing in my head. Maybe he's right. Maybe I'm not good enough. Maybe I'm too young. And fortunately, a mentor reached out to me and said, hey, Hoan, I'm so sorry you got this nasty email, but let me share a story with you, Hoan. And the mentor said to me, Hoan, imagine that you're in recess in elementary school, and you're running around having fun. All of a sudden, boom, you run into this kid, and his hands is a newspaper. On the front cover, it says, child killed. And as he lowers this newspaper, he looks you in the eye, and he says, when I grow up, I'm going to eradicate child slavery. And my mentor says, Hoan, this kid, elementary school kid, he's made fun of. He was criticized by his friends growing up. Like, how are you going to do this? But what's amazing is when you fast forward many years later, Craig Kielberger has the largest nonprofit worldwide called Free the Children, helping children educate other children on issues like this. He's backed by Oprah, the Prime Minister, Dalai Lama, and with his cause, and he has events all across Canada and parts of the United States called We Day, where they bring local celebrities, spokespersons, musicians, to help you guys realize you're not the leaders of tomorrow, you're the leaders of today. And he said to me, Hoan, Craig Kielberger had a unique gift to share. He had a passion that's impacting millions of children worldwide. He said, whether you know it or not, you have a unique gift that will impact millions of students worldwide. The reason why I share this story with you is because, again, I don't know you personally, but what I do know is that you have a unique gift to share. You have a passion. It could be in teaching, in business, in science, music, dance, whatever it is. You have a unique passion, a gift that can impact people not only at your schools, not only in your communities, but possibly around the world. My hope is you figure out and you try on different outfits is that when you find the right fit, you wear it. Why? Because there's so many people out there that you don't know that are depending on you. Now, here's the thing. Is it's not easy to do it. Why? Because there's a lot of haters out there, people that will not believe in you. And what's key is that you surround yourself around the right people. It's making sure you make meaningful connections in your life. Because I know for me, I remember in high school where my first year I was like, oh my gosh, I was making all these cool friends. But then after one semester, I realized they're not really friends, they're more acquaintances. You guys know what I'm talking about? People are there when it's really convenient, but when you really need them, they're not there. And what I realized is after my sophomore year, all these acquaintances, they got into drugs, they got into alcohol, and that wasn't my thing. Why? Because going to wrestling practice was tiring enough. And if I did this, it wouldn't help me out at all. So all of a sudden, they start making fun of me. They start talking behind my back. Like, oh, you're too cool for us? You want to study all the time? You don't have time to hang out anymore? And I had to make a tough decision. I had to say, you know what? I noticed when I was around these people, I wasn't myself. I was putting on a front, and I didn't like who I was becoming. I made the tough decision. I stopped hanging out with them, and I went down to like two friends, and all my lunches, I spent a lot of time with a career counselor focusing on my future. It was one of the most difficult things I had to do, but it was one of the most important things I did, right? Because in life, sometimes it's choosing the right thing over the popular thing. And for me, I just want you to think about is make sure you make meaningful connections, people there that are there for you. People are willing to help you reach your goals, not hold you back. People that are willing to breathe life into your dreams, not suck the life out of them. People that will build you up, not break you down. And what's key is that there's three relationships you should focus on that really support you, because I'm being real now where a lot of people are like, oh, Juan, you must be so excited all the time. Because what I'm like, I go through so many challenges. But the reason why I can not only endure but overcome them is because I have three specific relationships in my life. I call these the three M's. And what they are is make sure you have a mentor, mates, and mentees. Where mentors are people that believe in you when you stop believing in yourself. These are like your advisors, teachers, coaches, people who've gone down the path you want to go. Why is this important? Because at times, like, you just give up on yourself. I know with, like, when I had those suicidal thoughts, I had mentors, that professors there for me, that teacher, and he helped me to realize I had all the stress myself because I wanted to be successful so I can take care of my parents. And he says, Juan, only thing your parents want is for you to be happy. And in that moment, all of a sudden, all that stress started disappearing. Why? Because in that moment, I started to understand that my parents want me to be happy, but our parents' definition of happiness is very different from ours. Where, you know, our parents make sure that you're doing well financially, you don't have to struggle like they did, or make sure well that you feel good. And the thing is that oftentimes, a lot of parents don't understand. It's like, for us, like, being successful, it's not about just money. It's like doing something we love, we're passionate about. It's about making a difference in this world. In that moment, that's when it connected in my head. And then when I had that conversation with my parents, that's when our relationship started growing together, getting stronger. But if I didn't have that mentor to believe in me when times were tough, it would have been very difficult. So make sure you have mentors in your life. Make sure, in addition, you have mates. Mates are peers, someone that you can relate to. Why? Because there's times where I'm like, oh, all right, thanks, coach, for the advice. But I'm like, but you don't understand the challenges I'm going through as a junior in high school or this. So that's why it's make sure you have important friends in your life that you can confide in. It's having friends when times are tough that are really there for you, that will support you. I know for me in college, I met three best friends. And when we graduated, I knew it was so important. Like, I want to stay in touch with these guys. So we created a contract. We said, no matter how busy we get, we meet up every year. And we all signed it. And every year since we've graduated, we met every single year all across different parts of the world to connect and to support each other. And it's like, hey, what's up? How can I help you? If I didn't have those friendships, it'd be real difficult. Why? Because those people can understand me and I can be real with them. So I challenge you to think about your friends in your group. Are these friends? Are these mates that you can count on, or are these acquaintances? Lastly, is having mentees, people that you can support. Because for me, oftentimes in life, when times are tough, is that when you're helping other people, you forget about your challenges. And I think it's all about paying it forward. That's a big part about being a leader. So I want to encourage you, think about the people in your life, the relationships you have. Is, do you have mentors in your life? Do you have mates and mentees? These three relationships will do a game changer in helping you when times are tough. Because I'm not here to, again, to fluff and be like, oh, it's always positive, it's always good, because that's not the truth. Relationships is the key that will help you when times are tough, that will help you in your future goals in your life. These are the three relationships you need to make sure you need. Now, our time is winding down. We have about 20 minutes. And what I've realized is I never finished the story at the beginning. Remember the one with the rock star assignment, the acting class? Do you guys want to know what happened? Yeah. You sure?
Yeah.
Okay, so before I share that with you, this is something what we do. It's unique because we have some time. Is usually when I come to an event, I share what I believe will best support you. But what I realize, it's not about me. It's about you. So whether I have an opportunity to see you again, whether I speak at your school, at a conference you're a part of, and you bring me in, or not, I want to do my best to support you. So what I want to do now is unique. We have a large group, but we can make this happen, is I want to open up the floor to any questions. No holds bar. Ask me any question you want. Why? Because a lot of times people are like, Juan, why don't you talk about this? I'm like, well, why don't you ask a question? So this is your opportunity. I want to do my best to support you. So anything you want to ask regarding what we talked about, American Ninja Warrior, it doesn't matter. All I ask you is to say your name and what school you're from. So any questions or thoughts regarding our time together or questions you have in mind? Yes, in the back, go and stand up. Say your name very loudly in your school.
I'm Jared Vaughn from Rockwell, and how much can you deadlift?
So Jared's question is, how much can I deadlift? And quite frankly, I don't have an answer to that because I don't deadlift. Yeah, I don't deadlift. Say again? Oh, thanks, bro. Awesome. So yeah, I have no idea. But yeah. Yes. Say your name again?
Colton Rose.
Okay.
Okay, so the question is, can I get selfie? And the answer is, we'll do this for the sake of time, is I'm gonna be here right afterwards, right? So we'll have some buffer time before the breakout. So you meet me back there. Also, after you finish your breakouts, I'll be back here at the first part of lunch, so around 12 to about 12:20. Then I have to head to the airport, unfortunately, to make it somewhere else to speak. But I'll be back there so we can take selfies, hang out, all that good stuff. Other questions? Yes, we're here. Great question. So the question's regarding the girl. When I was like, hold up, that was whack. Did I get the girl? And then, yeah, so we went on a date afterwards. In the overall run, it didn't work out, but we're still friends and all that. But that wouldn't have happened if I did not pursue it. So, yeah. Other questions? Yes, back here. Go ahead and say your name.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Awesome. So Chantel's question is two. What high school grad from? So I'm from Washington State, right? So I'm not locally from here. So Washington State, yes, we got a Washington State shirt in the back. So I went to a school called Decatur High School. It's a public school in an urban area. And the second question is, well, come speak to school. I'd love to. So what in the back, what's going to happen is I have free postcards. I don't have them here, but I have postcards in the back. You can grab one. But what's important is I travel about 100 days a year, and I'm training for American Ninja Warrior again. So my schedule's super, super limited. So in the back of the table, after we finish, if you're interested in having me come speak at your school, is there four sheets of paper back there, write down your name and email, and we'll make sure to connect with you, and we can discuss ways to make that happen. All right? Great, thank you. Other questions? Yes?
So being a student council member, we're required to, like, or encouraged to include our student bodies into reach out to them. How,
yeah. So the question, this is an important question. This question is revolving, is like being a part of student council, you want to make sure everyone feels involved, but twofold is that it can feel overwhelming where you're like, oh man, I don't have time for me. So you can feel like you're always running on empty. And two is that, you know, how do you deal with the feeling of like you're honestly going, but you feel like it's not working and it's dealing with that emotion. Is that right? So number one, I want to share, this is very important, is you got to learn to say no to things. I know being leaders you are, student council, being at this conference, you like saying yes, you're willing to help. And there comes a point where you need to stop. Here's why. Is think about your cell phones. How many have a problem where at the end of the day, your phone's always on like
3%?
Right? So here's the thing. Is because there's so many apps running, you're searching the internet, all that stuff. Well, guess what? All throughout the day, you have a lot of apps running too in your life. You have your meetings. You have your events, plan for homecoming, plan for dances, you have sports, you have volunteering, and what happens by the end of the day, your battery's on 3%. And this is what I want to share with you, is that if you're operating at 3%, there's no way you can give 100%. And you're cheating not only your student body, but you're most importantly cheating yourself. So my biggest thing is you have to make time for you. You have to plug it in. Some of you are like, Juan, I don't have time, I'm too busy. And if you're in that thought process, let me ask you something. Do you brush your teeth every day?
Yes.
I hope so. Why? Because it's important. You make time for that. Just like every day, whether you have, you know, some schools are like, they have 7 periods a day, or some have a block schedule with like 3 periods a day. You know what time class is, and you don't miss class. Well, guess what? You need to make time for you, you don't miss it. Why? Because for me, there's times where even though I'm on a crazy travel schedule, every morning I wake up, I think about what I'm grateful for, I sing, and I exercise, and I think about what I'm, you know, my goals in my life. And for me, that's me charging myself every morning, because quite candidly, it was that I'm on a brutal, when I'm tired, I lose a lot of things. I lose expensive things. I've lost rental car keys. I lost USB scan disc just on this trip. And for me, I get frustrated. It's like, you know, Juan, guess what? Because you're not charging yourself up. So no matter how tired I am, I know I have to block out time for me. So I want to encourage you is realize if you feel guilty, you shouldn't feel guilty. If you feel selfish, you shouldn't. If you're feeling selfish, you should be selfish the fact that you're not taking care of you. So I want to encourage you, if you're feeling tired, you got to charge yourself back up. You got to plug yourself back in every single day. And the thing is, whatever makes you happy, whether it's reading a book, talking with a friend, whether it's journaling, but every day make that time for you. If you feel like you don't have the time, you're gonna have to say no to certain things. And people are like, oh, but wait, I need you to help me out. It's like, hey, you know what? I do wanna help you. I care for you so much, but I'm feeling burnt out right now. And if you give me some time, I promise you, I'll come back, I'll support you. But if you allow me to charge back up, I'll definitely help you. And when you have those candid conversations with your advisor, fellow student leaders, that's when things happen. Number two, second part of your question is, how do you deal with this frustration? Is realize this. Number one is, I focus on doing your best and forgetting the rest. Why? Because in life, there are things you can control and you can't. And the thing is, if you focus on things you can't control, you're always gonna be frustrated. Oh my gosh, you're doing all this work. Why isn't this change happening now? Well, some things happen overnight. But change is not happening now, but are you putting 100% effort in? That's something that your student council, only each and one of you will have the answer when you ask yourself that. And when you're committing 100%, that's all you can control. So I want to encourage you, if you're feeling yourself frustrated in your campus, like, oh my gosh, we're trying to get students more engaged, we're trying to make sure we break these cliques to get more people to come out, have more spirit at our school, realize, are you committing 100% effort? That's the first question. If you are, fantastic. If you're feeling frustrated, that's normal. But number two part of that is that sometimes when people give 100%, maybe if it's not working, then you have to give that 100% effort and try something else. Why? Because if you keep doing the same thing over and over again and you're not expecting a different result, now Albert Einstein calls it insanity. You're going to get frustrated. So make sure you give 100%. If something doesn't work, try it out for a certain period of time. If it doesn't work, it's okay. Try something else on. It's like a GPS. There's a car accident and you're supposed to go straight and you take a right. What does your GPS do? It reroutes. If it reroutes, you keep going. Now, all of a sudden, there's construction. You're supposed to go straight. You take a left. What does it do? Reroutes. That's the same attitude you need to have about life. So if something's not working that you guys are doing, it's all good. We just reroute. If that next thing doesn't work, reroute. And the key thing is, if you keep rerouting, eventually, if you don't stop, you'll get to your end destination. Does that help? Cool. Other question. We'll take a couple more. Let's go right here. Yeah, go ahead and stand up. Your name?
My name is Casey. What's your favorite?
Right. So question, wrestling, favorite takedown. For me, I was always a, I go high C to then double leg. Or for me, it was always, I always tie up, pull to right, and then I do an outside single. So those are my two go-to moves. Yes, and then go here. Yeah, definitely. So, questions about American Ninja Warriors. So, what happened was last year, I was climbing my cousin's CrossFit gym, his peg wall. He took a picture of me and he put hashtag beast mode, hashtag American Ninja Warrior. I was like, yeah, why not? So, I Googled American Ninja Warrior and I was like, okay, this is how you get in the show. The thing is, for me, you know, I had athletic background, all this, but I can't flip off buildings yet, right? Like some people can. So, for me, it's like, well, I know that they want a great story and you create a video to get on the show. So I said, I can paint a great story via video because one, being a speaker, athletic background, and then I know how to make things look good on camera. So we created a really good video and then we submitted it. But in addition, we had all my followers tweet the show, tweet the host. They start tweeting us back. So if you Google American Ninja Warrior season 6 audition video, if you just type in my name, H-O-A-N-D-O into Google, and put American Ninja Warrior, my video is the first thing that pops up into YouTube, into Google, right? So we put a lot of work in, and because of all that, I got on the show. I competed in Venice Beach, California. In the regionals, what happened was a week before I went, I snapped my ankle, right? I was going on a trampoline, and that was cool, and I snapped it. I couldn't walk 4 days before. So in my head, it's like, well, what's in my control? I hurt myself, can't control now that, it's already done. But if I want to still compete, what can I control? Well, one, I can do physical therapy, acupuncture, cool laser therapy. They have 3 hours of therapy every day for 4 days before I flew down to California. About 50%, I can actually walk now. Taped up my ankle, popped an ibuprofen, ran the course. When I ran through the course, there's a part where you go from bar to bar. When you go down into a cargo net, my foot slipped, so I lean into the water. I can feel it graze my butt. I go underneath, they don't say anything, right? So I go in the cargo net, I grab the bars, but then all of a sudden, they blow the whistle and the red light comes on because they zoomed in on my butt and they shot this little wet spot. So I was like, oh gosh. And it was like 2 a.m. when I went. People don't realize it's not filmed during the day. It's filmed like late at night. I go home 3 hours later. I get a phone call. I'm like, hey, what's up? They're like, hey, this is American Ninja Warrior. I'm like, yeah, how can I help you? They're like, hey, you left too early. I said, well, what do you mean? They say, well, not everyone finished the course, so we take the people who made it the farthest on the course, the top 30. So out of all the people, you're number 30. For real? Are you still here? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, come back tonight. You're going to compete on the city finals. So on TV, they have it spaced up by like a month. But in real life, it's like you compete one day, next day you compete in the finals, and then they just air it at two separate times. So I competed on the finals, and that picture at the beginning when I showed up on my social media, that was me climbing the bar on the city finals, and then that was actually aired on national television. So that was a cool experience in itself. The key lesson I take away, like leadership in life, is that's committing, doing your best, and forgetting the rest. Why? Because my goal was to make it to Mount, the first person. That happened this year. That wasn't me. I was bummed, but here's the thing. I was hurt. I was all this, but I did my best. And that's all you can ask. And that's why when you talk about goals and coming alive, you can come alive and have that feeling inside when you do your best because you can be proud of it. Only you know if you're shortchanging yourself, oh, I didn't do my best. So when you commit your best, you come alive inside. And what's key is that any goal, the purpose of any goal is not to achieve it. The purpose of every goal is that by pursuing it, you're going to do things you'd not normally do. You're going to learn things. You're going to experience new things. You're going to become a better person. Who you become in the process, that is why you pursue your goals. Achieving the goal is your cherry on top. So awesome. So our time's winding down. Again, if you have questions, like I said, I'll be in the back, the center table. If you take a look back, that center table, that's where we have the postcards. If you're interested in having me come to your school, if you're part of another leadership organization like DEC and all that stuff, FBLA, you can write your info back there. I'll be there right after we're done and right before lunch. And before we end, a couple things. One is I want to acknowledge a couple people here, groups. The first group of people are people who work so hard, and I don't think they get appreciated enough. These individuals help me to succeed not only in school but in life. So if I can, I'd like to have all the advisors, all the adults that came here, you brought your students here, to stand up for me. What us do is clap our hands and make some noise. Also, this event is a massive undertaking, and it's a small team with a big heart that puts us on. So if we can have all the staff members from the Leadership Center, if we can, Ms. Belinda, your staff and team, if you can stand up for me, all the staff members and volunteers that put this conference together, we give you guys a round of applause for all what you guys do. Awesome. So again, if you want to stay in touch with me, again, I'll be back here. Also, again, social media, all that good stuff. Oh, forgot. If you want to stay in contact, you can go to thatiswhack.com. Social media. Also, here's the cool thing, is the Leadership Center, they're giving away cool prizes, but you need a tweet to get them. So here's the tweet to send out. You put at Juan Doe, that is whack, because then you play your new song when we did exercise, whatever it is, that I got swag, whatever it is. Tweet that out and make sure you hashtag UVU lead, and they'll be drawing out a prize raffle what you get. All right, so going back to the story, this is what happened. I was contemplating back and forth. Should I do this assignment? Should I not? And I said, you know what? I'm going to do it. Why? One, I don't want to fail. But two, as leaders, we should never be hypocrites. If you're going to say something, you follow through. And I was the type of person like, dude, don't let fear hold you back from what you want. And I would be a hypocrite if I didn't follow my own advice. So I decided to do this song. I said, if I'm going to do it, I'm going to go all out. So the random song I chose was Hey Mickey. You guys know that song from Pitch Perfect? So I chose a song, and then I called my friend Janine, who's a cheerleader from our school. And I said, Janine, random question, can I borrow your cheerleading outfit? She says, Juan, I'll let you borrow my outfit as long as you promise me you will not stretch it out. Janine, I promise. After putting on the skirt, thank you. I realized a lot tighter than I expected, so I grabbed a random shirt from my closet. So here's the thing, I didn't know anything about cheerleading, so what did I do? I got the Bring It On movie and watched it. Now, before I know it, it's like the day of the assignment. Teacher yells out, Juan, are you ready? Ready as I ever will be. Hold on a second, Mr. Campbell, I forgot something. It just got turned up. Music? Let's cue this up, man. This is the real deal. If not, we have a backup plan. All right, we'll go back up. Enjoy the moment now. There we go. So after I do this assignment, I realize that's the most embarrassing thing I've ever done. But as I look back, I'm glad I did it. Why? Because it taught me what it takes to succeed. For me, I was so nervous to do this assignment, but I realized, Hoan, it's okay, you don't have to be positive. It's make sure you have the right attitude, acknowledging how you feel. For me, I was like, I want to do this assignment, but I'm so scared, but I'm thinking, Hoan, you gotta do it for you, not care about other people's thoughts, because this is the passion that you want to learn this moment for this class. Lastly, it's surrounding myself and making meaningful connections. I had a support group that helped me when I was scared to do this assignment. They're like, at first they're like, dude, what are you doing? But then when they saw me do it, they're like, dude, you killed it. So my hope is this, as you continue on with this conference this school year, you realize your ability to succeed doesn't come down to where you come from, your age, your background, skin color, what you have. It comes down to choices you make. It's making sure you have the right attitude when times are tough, making sure you find that right outfit for you, and making sure you make meaningful connections. And if that's too much to remember, you just need to remember this one thing then. If times are tough, you have that wax song, all you need to do is change the station by saying,
hold on, that is whack.
Come by, say hello. Thank you so much, guys.
Ooh.